talks a lot. That's good. And it's good to be here today. Kind of wish we had could sing that last song at the very end, because that really sums up what I want to end up by saying today, how much God loves you. And a few weeks ago, Craig Rowley was here, and I watched his sermon online, and he did a great job, and I kind of want to follow up what he was saying. I don't know if you remember that or not. And then somebody gave me this verse as they were praying for me today about, and that kind of made me take what I'm going to say very seriously. I want to give it to you here. It's 1 Peter 4:11. Listen to this. It says, if anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. And that's kind of sobering. I'm just a man. I'm just a guy here today. But I want to, what if what I have to say becomes for you the words of God, something you actually need to hear today for your future, maybe for your survival, for something that's going to make a huge difference in your life? I think that's really amazing. So pray with me just a moment. God, man, I got these words going in my head, and I've thought about all kind of things I want to say to these students. And what if they could become your words today? That it could be life-changing in some way. And Lord, you know, I feel real humble about being able to speak here today. And yet, I want to declare a couple truths from your word that perhaps maybe there's just one student that needs to hear this. Or maybe a dozen, or maybe a couple hundred, I don't know. But God, I want to say these words as if they're your words today. So would you help me and help students to be able to listen and hang in here with me for the next few minutes? In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to show you a little clip of an old TV show that I, you know, it's kind of funny, maybe for old people, I don't know. But I kind of like this show. It's called Little Big Shots, and I used one of these a few years ago when I was here. And I'll tell you why I show it after we watch it. So let's just watch this.
All the way from Ethiopia in Africa, here's the Kariku Brothers.
Crazy, huh? And I showed that to you partly because it's just so fun and it's great. But I think I want to use that as a metaphor. You know what a metaphor is? Here's an English lesson. A metaphor in the song, that the last song we sang, we said, love's like a hurricane. That's a simile, when something is compares something. But when you use a metaphor, the next phrase is, and I am a tree. Nicole isn't a tree, but she says in that phrase, I am a tree. That's a metaphor. So it's an illustration of something, right? To me, this is a metaphor for what I would like my life with Jesus, my Christian life to be like, to be. I would like it to be exciting, daring, free, totally free, taking some risks, lots of fun, exciting, you know, on the move. That's why I like my Christian life to be. And I think every one of us kind of have this image that's what the image that we have of walking with Jesus and living for him ought to be like, something like that every day. It'll be like chapel every day, like what the worship leaders were doing today. And yet, the truth is, I bet you for some of you here this morning, from the day you accepted Jesus to now, you're asking, what happened? Where's the happiness? How come there's this kind of low-grade sadness that I seem like I'm living with almost all of the time? It's not what I expected, not what I was told. What happened? I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to tell you what I think about that. I think it's because we accept two different lies that are out in our world today. I'm going to call one of them the lie of the world. The second one is the lie of the devil. And just see if that fits for some of you today who have lost some of that edge, some of that joy, that you wouldn't, if you would draw a picture of your Christian life, it wouldn't be a movie like that. It'd be something more like maybe driving a, riding grandma's bicycle, beachcomber or something, you know. And what happened? So before I tell you what those lies are, let me tell you how lies work and how we get there. Okay, so here's another illustration. Not really, more of an illustration of that. Do you know how they train circus elephants to be obedient? Maybe some of you heard this. But here's a picture of an elephant, a beast, probably the most powerful animal in the world, out in the savannah, just free to roam and range and do everything, anything it pleases, right? The epitome of a complete illustration of actual strength. And yet when we see one of those elephants, if it's outside of a zoo or at a circus, how can it be controlled by just a little rope around its ankle? The secret is that when that elephant was a baby, like this little baby elephant here, that looks kind of sad, but look at that chain. There's a chain around its ankle, tied to a tree or to a stake or something. And for the first week, that little elephant pulls against that chain, and he pulls and he pulls and he pulls, because he knows this is not what I was born to be, not what I was born to do. And so he fights against that. He does it for another week and another week. For several weeks, he just pulls and pulls and pulls against that chain. And then one day, something clicks in his brain. And that click is a lie that says, well, I guess I was not destined to be free after all. My destiny is to be, to kind of walk around in a circle and just to be controlled by whatever is around my ankle. And so for the rest of his life, until he grows up to be that giant beast that we saw, for the rest of his life, all you have to do is put a little piece of rope, a piece of twine, maybe sometimes even nothing around his ankle. And in his mind, that elephant, that beast that was created to roam and to be free and to have power and do anything it wanted to do, believes this lie that I'm just destined to walk around in a circle and to be controlled by a little piece of rope. That's the lie, and that's how lies work in our lives too, kids. When we believe the lie of the world and the lie of the devil, it begins to control us, and we don't live the life that we saw in the metaphor of those two kids just flying through the air, defying all odds, defying nature, taking risks, having absolute fun in the life that God called us to live in Jesus. So let me tell you what those two lies are, and I've experienced them. So I'm speaking from my personal experience this morning. The first lie, called the lie of the world, and it's this lie. No wonder you're not very happy, because the Christian life is boring and it's limiting. It's life out there, wherever that is, somewhere out there, in what we sometimes call the world, but it's life out there that's exciting, and you can't experience that kind of joy that those other kids have because you've accepted Jesus and he's limiting you. Now, where does that come from? It's a lie of the world. There are a lot of joy suckers in our world, and you find them all over the place. Sometimes they're even among believers, and even sometimes they're in our churches. People that are always frowning and criticizing and complaining about how bad things have gotten. And it's only natural that someone who doesn't know Jesus would think that way. There's a worldview that's called naturalism. Naturalism is the idea that what we see in this natural world around us is really all that there is. So we're limited to that. We're limited to what we can see, what we can understand. It's a kind of the scientific method that says that's all that there is to life. So obviously, you know, you want to just live for this world and live for this time and live for this life. And yet we know that there's this desire to, there's this thought out in almost every person out in our world that there's this idea there must be something more out there. I mean, look at the movies that are, in the last 20 years, most of them have had something to do with another world, another power, a superpower or something. And yet people, the lie that the world keeps telling us is that no, you just go out there and have fun and just go live for yourself. Do whatever you please. That's where the fun is. That's where the joy is. And if you're going to accept Jesus, you're going to live his way, you're not going to be very happy. So I'm here this morning again to remind you that Jesus himself said, he said, I am the way. I am the truth. I'm not a lie. I'm the truth. And I am the life. And that life that he wants to offer you is the life of absolute, complete fulfillment. In fact, he said in John chapter 10, verse 10, I have come that you might have life, and that you might have it to the full. And Jesus is the one that can offer that to you if you will trust him completely with your life, if you will give your life totally to him. Don't believe the lie of the world. Because what it offers, because it's a lie, it's a deception. And if you follow after that, it only leads to another kind of slavery, another kind of enslavement to whatever you're pursuing. Whatever you think is going to make you happy is really going to then begin to control you. It's going to rob you of the real joy that Jesus Christ wants to give to you. The second lie is what I call the lie of the devil. And it goes something like this. It says, you know, God's actually kind of ticked off at you. You know, he maybe is a God of love, but you're really not quite good enough for God, and you probably won't ever be, so why don't you just give up? Why don't you just quit? And I want to tell you, that's the lie that I lived for quite a while after I accepted Jesus into my life. I know many of you have received Christ as your Savior. You're trying to walk with him. But for me, I did that when I was in junior high. And then for the next 10 to 15 years, I lived kind of like I lived the lie of the world, but I also was a victim of the lie of the devil that said exactly what this lie says. I just wasn't good enough. I never was going to be quite good enough for God, and so there was this low-grade kind of disappointment that I had with everything about myself and about life. And you know what's so crazy about that? It was really the opposite of the life that God had allowed me to live. I really had experienced what for a teenager, for someone in high school and in college would be a lot of success. I enjoyed a great deal of success. I had a fantastic high school experience. I got to be student body president. I enjoyed a lot of success in sports. Not to the degree that some of you have enjoyed this year, but a great deal. And then when I went to college, it just got better. Just got better. Somehow God put me in an environment. I didn't have the kind of coaching that you guys have. I didn't have the training, the weight training, the sports medicine and all that kind of stuff. But somehow we still did our best. And I got to achieve a great deal of what you would call worldly success on a human level. I got to be chairman of the sports club, the spiritual organization in my college. You think that would be pretty cool and a blessing, and it was. I got to experience a lot of success in the area of sports, and I don't want to be boastful here, but just to tell you that I just loved playing whatever sport was in season, and I got to do that. And so I got to achieve a certain amount of success. I got to meet almost every one of my goals in college as a basketball player. I got to achieve more goals than I even surpassed my goals in track and field. I got to be an All-American in track and field. I never lost in my state until I got into the Division I in the intermediate hurdles. So it was fun. I was having a great time. I had all the success that you could kind of imagine in almost every level of leadership and sports, had great relationships. I even got to date the cheerleader. The cheerleader. Not only did I get to date her, I got to marry her. And you can tell her, I mean, when she was in college, she was hot, okay? Tell Mrs. Fast I said that. So here's the deal, though. I had all of that going for me, and I'm not trying to be boastful. I just want to show you, you can have all of that, and yet inside there was this low-grade kind of sadness that just lingered with me. You know, when I was pretty young, some adults said something to me that wounded my spirit. I don't know if any of you have had that experience. I don't blame them for it today because I know now it wasn't intentional. But in a setting where I was the only child in the room, some adults turned toward me and said something that just broke my spirit. And I lived with that for about 20 years. It took me years to overcome that. I'm going to say that partly, guys, think about what you say to other people. Seniors, think about what you say to freshmen. Faculty, think about what you say to your students. I know we don't need to coddle people, and you know, I'm not talking about babying people and never saying the truth. But there are sometimes we can say things in certain settings that can wound a person, and there can be a wound in their heart that takes years to overcome, and that was my experience, and I brought that into my life. And for all those years, I just felt like I never was good enough. You know, a person that lives with that lie, in spite of all the success, will find themselves somewhere along what I call this continuum here. And this didn't come out very good. I was intending that to be spread out. But on the one side is this kind of insecurity. And you begin to kind of withdraw from people, and you don't want to be noticed. You just want to stay in the background and just kind of leave me alone. In the middle on that line is more of an idea of being just sad and lethargic, just being sad and not finding the joy that you look around, you see other people, they seem happy, and yet you don't have it. But clear on the other side is what we call despair, and that despair is the point in which people want to give up. And friends, I was on that line, and I was moving towards despair. In spite of all that success that I was experiencing, I was moving in that direction. You know what the end of despair is? I want to talk to you for just a few moments about a difficult subject, and I want to say it very carefully. I want you to listen very carefully because it's very serious, and I'm not saying this to plant any ideas in anybody's mind. But do you know today that the third leading cause of death among young people in our country is suicide? It's people who have bought this lie, and they've moved from just being kind of withdrawn to being sad to giving up. Here's what suicide is. It's a permanent solution to a temporary problem. Since 1999, there has been an increase of attempted suicide among young people. And among teenage girls, it has increased 200%. And students, I'm here today to appeal to you to say, God loves you. Oh, how he loves you. His love, he loves like a hurricane. And we are like a tree just receiving that. I want you to receive that. I want you to hear that today. That God loves you. See, what happened to me, I was moving towards despair. In spite of all that success, in spite of all that blessing, I was moving toward despair until one day, I just, I just cried out to God in my despair and I gave up. I just cried out to God and I said, God, I can't do this. My dad was a pastor. I was supposed to be this good kid, and I just seemed like I never measured up. And finally, I just said, God, I can't do it. I just can't do it. And I want to tell you, and I've told some of you this before, that for the first time, for the basically the only time in my life, I heard the most audible voice of God. I want you to be careful when you say, God told me something. It's really a risky thing to do, and sometimes God gets blamed for some really weird things that people say, well, God told me to do this or to go there. But on this occasion, I didn't hear it out loud, but in my spirit, I just heard God call me by name. And he said, Dennis, it's okay. I've taken care of it. Today we'd say, I've got your back. And something happened at that moment. That lie that I had believed suddenly turned upside down. I began to believe in the love of God for me that was greater than anything else in this whole world. See, the opposite of lie is a truth. And Jesus said in John 8:32, he had already said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And in John 8:32, he says, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And students, I'm here to just tell you today that the really only true freedom that we can find in this life is in Jesus. It is still in him. No matter what the lies of the world or the lies of the devil, who is a deceiver, he is a liar. And he wants to accuse you, and he wants to discourage you, he wants to defeat you. He wants to kill you. He really does. He finds no more joy than when someone destroys their own life, when they totally destroy their life. And so I'm here today just to remind you about how much God loves you. In spite of the lies that you've heard, the lies in your head, the stories that you've been told, what other people around you are saying, God loves you. I want to just invite you today to reach out and experience God's love again. Here's Romans 8. There's a bunch of verses in the end of Romans 8 that just talk about God's love. I love where it says, if God is for us, who can be against us? It's a great question. No one. The answer is no one. And Paul goes on there to say, who can separate us from the love of Christ? For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any other powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Would you receive that today as if those were the words of God? I came to you today humbly, but someone said that I was supposed to speak as if I were speaking the very words of God, and I want you to hear that today. I want you to receive God's word to you today. We're going to wrap this up real quickly, but I'm asking you if you would just show me the respect of closing your eyes and not try not to be aware of the people around you. I'm not going to do anything weird or ask you to come forward or anything like that, but I do want to just ask you to just listen for a moment for the voice of God in your spirit, to hear God telling you how much he loves you. I don't know if any of you have been moving towards that, towards despair. I know that some of you here have been wounded. Some of you here have felt discouraged. Some of you have been mistreated. Some of you are in an environment where you don't experience, when you walk out of these doors, when you walk off this campus, you don't experience a lot of love. But I want you to know that God wants to carry you through that. God wants to surround you with his love. He wants to say to you what he said to me that day, that the day that changed my life. When he called me by name and he said, Dennis, I love you. I've taken care of it. You don't have to do any more. When I died on the cross, I paid for all your sins, and I love you. Do you need to receive that today? Do you need to hear that today from the word from God himself? Please receive it through me today as God's gift of love to you, that he loves you. As we dismiss in just a few moments, I want to just say that I'm going to stick around for a little while, and Grant is going to be here for a little bit. If this is a message that you needed to hear because you feel like giving up, we'd love to just show you a few more scriptures that can encourage you and pray with you for a few moments. I know the teachers would excuse you, but if you want to do that, I'd love to pray with you a little bit more and just show you from God's word how much he loves you. God, I thank you for these students. I thank you for Emmanuel. I thank you for this faculty and their dedication to you and to being the best that they can be and to providing an education for these students that is going to prepare them for going out and living in this world, a world that's full of lies and where they face the temptations and the doubts and the deception of our enemy, the devil, every day. Lord, I pray that you would prepare each one, that you would heal the wounds that lie in some of their hearts. That we just lift them up and help us to go from here and to show the world that's watching the joy that's ours because we trust in Jesus completely, that we have found in him everything that we need, that he has given us everything we need for life, for how to live a godly life, how to live a full life. And we thank you for that, Lord Jesus. Bless these students as they go to their classes, their activities, as they look forward to this weekend, and many of them are going to go on a trip tomorrow and this weekend and just have a blast. Lord, keep them in your care. Help them to experience the joy of the Lord everywhere they go. I pray this in the strong name of Jesus. Thank you for loving us. Amen. Okay. Seniors?